Introducing the band that you've all been waiting for. From the lead CEO of the world, the man you all know, the man you love, the man you hate, James Barnhart. This is Liquid Crystal.
Yes. Well done. Look at you.
Dude. Oh, wait a minute. Let me turn that off.
Reverb. Okay. That was bad. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yep, yep.
Oh, wait. Hold on.
Whoa.
There we go. I can hear.
Whoa. What's up, man? Looking good over there,
dude. I've got a professional setup now.
It's a new camera. You're using your other camera. Is that what you're right?
Yes. So I have a Sony camcorder that I got last year when I did the Human Origins conference, which is a 4K camcorder. Okay. So I have that plugged in, and you can't just plug a camera like that directly into the computer. You need a special device,
right?
Like a capture device. So I have that plugged into, I have a switcher. I have this big box underneath my desk right now. So it's got a mixer, a switcher, and a recorder. So the mixer is what I have this microphone plugged into, and also the computer audio. So now instead of having to control the audio like on the computer, I can do it all like on like actual dials and faders and shit like that.
Sweet. Yeah, you showed me the mixer last time, I think, or something.
Yeah. And this microphone is the one we use at Uncle Bruce's when we shoot videos for him, and it just sits there. It actually still has dust on it. So I told him, like, I'm just going to take this.
Yeah, why not?
You know, like, I'll bring it back. I'll just bring it up with all the other stuff I bring. Figure better get some use out of it. And then also, yeah, so I got the mixer, the switcher, and I also got some lights set up. I got, like, a backlight up here that you can't see, and then I got this one over here to get a little bit more lighting. Yeah, man.
Professional apps.
Very, very professional. And I love it too, because the mixer, obviously you can do so much mixing with it. You can EQ and fucking bring up the bass and get so much more control. It's great. I spent like the better part of the day just getting that all figured out. And
sweet. It's all good and set up, official.
All good, all official, all set up. How you doing, man?
Not bad, you know, taking it easy. Not much going on. It's weird kind of not having mandala to work on like every night. I know I will after this, but you know, I was working on that other script and then straight into mandala for like a couple of months. So it's been weird having like just nights where I don't really have anything to do. So just been kind of hanging out. But good. Been power washing my parents' patio, which is satisfying, but
very nice.
No complaints from me, man. Yeah, you had a good fourth and all that stuff.
Yeah, it was good. We went over to Mike's house, and Steve ended up going over to his friends from college, their place. They did a little barbecue, and Mike and I hung out. We went on the roof and were drinking and watching the fireworks go off, which is really cool because apparently Mayor Garcetti put out a commandment that no illegal fireworks were to be set off because of, like, I don't know, pandemic or blah, 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 whatever the fuck it was, fire, whatever. And it was at the same time too, I think Fox News put out a statement saying that the three least patriotic states in the country were New York, New Jersey, and California. And we're sitting on the roof and we're just watching all these fucking fireworks go off. It was like a war. It was like War of the Worlds, man. It was just all night, all night. And it was 360 degrees too. Just really cool sitting on the roof. And, you know, just like, suck it. We are not, we are one of the most patriotic states in the nation.
Yeah. Classic. Of course, Fox News hates California. Well, I remember when we were living downtown and we went on the roof during the 4th of July. It was the same thing.
Yeah.
And Dodger Stadium was having like fireworks. So that, I remember that being, yeah, all the way at 362. Right. There was fireworks fucking everywhere.
Yeah, we were talking about that and how the big difference though with this was when we were downtown, since we were in sort of a like industrial area, the fashion district, I guess, yeah, all the fireworks were, you know, pretty distant. They were, yeah, they were everywhere, but they were, you know, in the periphery distance.
True.
Where we were on the roof in Koreatown, they were going off like the street next uh-huh. over to us. So it was just like boom, boom, boom. It was awesome. It was really cool. Very interesting experience. Yeah, had a good time. Pretty chill.
Nice. That's good. That's about all you can do this 4th of July, I guess. Just have a chill one.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was, it was that night actually, like while I was on the roof, Uncle Bruce called me and he's like, "Hey, I read Mandala. You have any, did you get my email?" I'm like, "Oh shit." And like, I just noticed then that he got the email. I was like, "All right, Jules, just give me a call in the morning. I'll want to talk about it." So I was like, "All right, hell yeah." So I called him around like noon the next day and, wow, it was good.
How did he sound?
Oh, it sounded great. Let me put it in this context first. The first time, the only other time that he read it was what, like 10 years ago?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't remember, but it's been a long time, yeah. I was trying to think of that as well. I couldn't remember the last time he did.
For what it's worth, the draft that we had him read was like bullshit compared to like what it is now. Right. Like, yeah, like I remember sitting in my parents' living room when he was giving me those notes and how defeated I felt. It was just like, oh God, like, oh no. It was like every page there was something fucking wrong.
Right.
And it wasn't like a surprise either. So I was like, oh God, no. And it's like, but, so with that in mind, this particular note reading went really, really well. And as you saw in the notes that he gave, the actual email that he wrote, not many notes, not many consequential notes, except for the last ones, which we're going to get into. Mm-hmm. Some of the things he was writing, like, I love the note where he's like, "Prolly, was that like a hip hop phrase?" Yeah. Like, Jesus, Uncle Bruce. You don't say that in public. yeah, it's a hip hop phrase.
Sure.
But let me start off with this before, you know, just in my interpretation of it, after he explained all of his feelings and thoughts about everything. I asked him, like, okay, other than those things, which I agree, and we'll get into, other than those things, like, how was everything else? Like, did we do good leading up to that? Like, and he's like, absolutely. It's like, I was with you the whole time up until the end.
That's awesome.
And I'm like, great. And it was a little bit surprising, but not really. Mm-hmm. I think, like, what I chalk it up to is how these last two drafts were very much focused on, I mean, yeah, there was a lot of like, let's take the stuff out. Let's take the characters out. We don't need, let's take out all the scenes we don't need. But I would say, and I think you would agree, that the, one of the biggest changes that came with these last two drafts was Lily, like developing her character, giving her more of a voice, which even Francis Bacon didn't have a fucking voice.
Yeah, that was always, we've been struggling with that for so long.
Yeah. And I was
focused on her a lot more
this time. Yes. And I think based on the way Uncle Bruce read it, which we're about to get into, I think what my deduction is that we got a little bit too too in like too convoluted in terms of like what it is that she's like, what's going on in her mind, and also like how that translates into onto the page. Mm-hmm. Specifically the concept of whether or not like what he said when he at that scene with Barnhart, when Barnhart kills Chris, mm-hmm. First thing he said was like, well, yeah, that was shocking, but I didn't really care about Chris.
Right.
Chris was just basically there to have sex and that was it.
Yeah.
And like, you know, in our minds, that is absolute, like, I mean, that makes sense. Like that's like, I mean, in our minds, I think when we were really doing this, it was like, okay, Chris is a distraction. He's there literally like, well, you can ignore Jeff and come hang out with me. That's right. Been like his status quo, like the whole time. Mm-hmm. And he really was emphasizing to me, not just on this call, but when I was up there last in Santa Cruz, how one of the things that really like blew his mind as he was writing the treatment was this idea that like when Mandala and Liquid Crystals, when Liquid Crystals playing their final performance at the end, how like and we'll get into all the, I think these are going to be pretty easy fixes, honestly, but Lily goes out, like in his mind, Lily goes out on stage thinking that, you know, it comes to the conclusion the president's going to get assassinated and we took care of it. Somebody's going to notify the president, basically inform give that recording that Matt has to the president, mm-hmm. which it's like Chris is going to do that. Chris was like already pivotal in that, like with that scene where he's vaping out in the fucking moonlight by the, you know, like in the road by himself, like when Matt's going to give him the thing. It's just, we need to move that down a little bit, keep that. So it's like, the idea is when Lily goes, Lily should not at all think that she's the one, that she's the target. Mm-hmm. That was like one of his biggest notes. That he should not.
Hey, Thor.
She should not know that she's the one. Cause like clearly like in that Barnhart scene, even the way he read it, he was like, oh shit. Like, does she know she's about to get killed? She's going to go out on stage and basically commit suicide. Like what the fuck? She's throwing everything away. Like why is she doing that? Is that what she's doing? It's like Barnhart's like, you know, it's already been done. It was like ambiguous, but also like kind of like we presented like both paths. It was almost like the Spoon Session thing. Like, yeah, it's going to go both ways. But I think, you know, based on the way Uncle Bruce received it, it was like, and hearing him express it, it's like, yeah, that's the ultimate twist to the story, is that she's the target. We don't want to really, I don't think we want to make her aware or seem aware that she's the target.
The whole battle was, if she thought the president was the target, she'd go out and say something into the microphone. That was the
right.
whole.
Yes. And I told that to him. I expressed that to him, like one of the biggest issues, like as we've developed it over the last 10, 13 years, whatever. That was something that recently, I think it was at the Monolith when we realized that, like, wait a minute. If there's this big conspiracy and she goes out on stage, she has the perfect opportunity to just tell everybody what the fuck's going on. Like, get the fuck out of here. Why doesn't she do that? And Uncle Bruce is like, no, that's not what was in the original story. In the original story, Chris was bringing the documents or whatever to the president. So like right before she goes out on stage, it was like, it was the building up. And it's like right before she goes out on stage, it's like Chris, who needs to have much more character development, much more trust, be a much more believable character, almost like on the same level as Jeff. Like the way it is right now, it's like he's clearly a distraction. He's mm-hmm. clearly just a fuckboy.
Yeah.
And if he were to be a more substantial character to the point where we actually believe that he's trustworthy, so that when it comes down to that point somewhere in there, when Lily gets the recording, Matt's recording, you know, modify the scene with Barnhart a little bit. Barnhart shouldn't kill Chris. Lily, like in the like frantic, like kind of like PA's coming out. We got 5 minutes till, you know, fucking shows up or whatever. And then Lily gives Chris the recording, like mm-hmm. maybe like gives her the phone or gives just like file transfer or whatever the fuck, gives him the recording, and Chris is gonna go deliver that to the president or the president, and that could be plausible because if Lily's got connections with the president, maybe there could be even a scene. I'm just thinking of this now. Maybe there could be a scene where Lily and Chris are hanging out with the president. This is going to take a step back further a little bit. One of Mike's notes was about leaning more into the political thriller genre. Like in those notes that the we got from the screenwriting contest, like identifying the genre. I think, and Uncle Bruce agreed, it's like this is a political thriller with science fiction, it's not science fiction, but like science overtones.
Yeah.
And also kind of like behind this music documentary movie a little bit.
Yeah.
So like behind the music documentary lens, like that's the public perception, but then there's the political thriller that's going on. So leaning more into that, there could be a scene where Lily and Chris should be much more than just sex. It should be sex and a real confidence. Like there should be much more, Chris should be so fucking believable. Like he's actually like a really good guy. Like one of the last good guys, you know, like Jeff and Matt are the detectives right now. They're like her only like pillars of integrity. But Chris should also be a pillar of integrity so that when Lily is like, we only have much time, and Chris, and she's like, Chris is like, I'll bring it to the president. We met, you know, maybe if there's a scene where they meet or something. Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Here. He's like, okay. So like right before she goes on stage, she hands it to Chris, and Chris is like, all right, I'm on it. And then we can show like Chris, like make it look like he's really going to give the fucking, like he's really on, like we believe it. Like he's on our side. Yeah. And he's on his way to deliver.
We've had that in earlier when it was the other way around. When yes. Christy went over and tried to give the president something, I think. But I don't remember exactly how it went. But yeah, and then.
Because then
when she knows it fails is when he's at side stage.
Yes.
Like with a gun to him. Right. That was
no. I don't even think there should be a gun to him. It's just like it should just be like that's like one of the shocking moments. Like that's one of the that's a preamble shocking moment to the moment right before Lilith gets killed. Is that our fucking the one person that was alive still that we still trust was actually on their fucking side the mm-hmm. whole time, like Jennifer.
Right.
Yeah, like where Jennifer was on the side stage now. Like, you know, it's like maybe she could be there, but seeing Chris there, if we develop his character more, seeing Chris there on the side stage, that's going to be when Lily realizes while she's mid performance,
right, that
the fucking thing is compromised.
Yeah. But
it's too late. Hmm. And now the other big thing that Uncle Bruce brought up, which is like, I did not even fucking think about this is
exactly what that. That's the kind of shit we need. The shit that we didn't even fucking think about.
Yeah. Yeah. And dude, this is going to be kind of funny because it's the title of the movie Mandala. Right. And we have all this stuff like mandala imagery and she's designing a mandala album cover and all this stuff. And Uncle Bruce like flat out just said, he's like, basically the name Mandala has nothing to do with this movie. It's like, you could basically, that's like a MacGuffin. Like I interpret it, it's like, that's a MacGuffin. It has, there's no mention of mandalas in terms of the, he's like, you have to understand, Alex, the whole thing about this was about the hypnosis and mind control aspect. And the idea there should be a scene in there tantamount to like when somebody is doing hypnosis upon you and they put you under hypnosis and you're under, and then the guy is guiding you and he's like, all right, what you're going to do is you're going to believe that you're a dancing monkey. And when I snap my fingers, you will wake up. And it's like the snap of the fingers moment. That's when you wake up and you're a dancing monkey. Mm-hmm. So there needs to be some scene like that, similar to the Pentagon scene. This will also, I think, build up the political thriller aspect of it. You know, because like I think in back of my mind too, it's like, it was wondering how much do we actually disclose about their fucking secret plans. Like there's that whole thing in the Pentagon where we talk about that. There's a scene with Vincelli Barnhart and Dr. Dean, you know, in the fucking at Stanford. Like, that's a new scene that elaborates more on like what their fucking evil plan is. And I think in the back of my mind, subconsciously, I'm sure we talked about it too, is also is like, you know, we were trying to be cautious about how much to say. But Uncle Bruce made it kind of clear. It's like, all that stuff is fair game to disclose to the audience. The thing that we want, absolutely want to shock people with, is that she's the target, not the president.
Right.
So like by that point in the movie, at the end, we want people to recognize that there's this vaccine going around, doing this shit, which sidebar, Uncle Bruce said, he's like, I'm going to, when you do this next draft, he's like, I'm going to go through and I'm going to give you more specific science that actually, like, cause he's like, I read sensory nerve cells, like operating. It's like, that's not what it does. It doesn't do that. It's really all about this science called optogenetics. And I'm like, oh shit. Okay. Well, like fucking, he's like, yeah, but that's not important right now. Like just get the, get these things ironed out and then like go back, he'll go back and like, we can modify the science, make it like actually scientifically valid. But, so the whole idea is at the end of the movie, we should be aware that A, there is a mind control situation going on with a mandala, like a mandala essentially, like the laser like the mandala needs to be like disclosed on a level that maybe Lily should be somewhat aware of. She has to be somewhat aware of like this concept of this like mandala. Cause the thing at the end, like when the big opal medallion and the dragon mandala appears, it was like, yeah, that was there, but it wasn't built up in the way that made Uncle Bruce feel comfortable that like, that was like the whole point was like when Lily looks over and sees Chris standing there, realizes that, oh shit, the president did not get the message. And then the fucking dragon mandala appears and she turns around and sees it. And she's like, holy shit, this is the mandala. And then she's like, oh fuck, I'm the target. Boom, dead.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there needs to be some sort of like scene or building up. Like we have, I love all the stuff we have in there with the mandalas already, because that's really like her, her take on it. But we need to have some sort of like, I don't know, it's Dr. Teen or fucking Matt or a combination of these guys or some like another, like a third, you know, got the Pentagon scene. We've got the scene at Stanford. There should be like a third, you know, scene and an arc structure of like disclosing what this fucking mind control experiment's all about. Mm-hmm. So that like the whole thing is that when we see the mandala, that's when we fucking, that's when it, and in conjunction with the fact that Chris is not on her side, that's when like it all like all of a sudden she realizes, holy fuck, I'm the target. And then that's when the flashes go off and okay. She killed. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Totally. Totally does.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's how it was in the OG draft. I do remember that. Yeah. The main character looks and sees the person who they thought was helping them. Like the last hope was also standing side stage next to the bad guys, and that was like the double gawk. Yeah, and I remember, and then looks up at the dragon mandala, and then yeah, everything comes together in that moment, leaving her no time to say anything into the microphone or run over, like the show is in full. Yeah, like, and she's kind of paralyzed by it. Yeah, that all makes complete sense.
Yeah, and you know, like it's still like all the stuff, it's cool that it came, it was a really good sign to me, like after like Uncle Bruce is really emphasizing these things, he's like, this is what you like, you need, the ending, they need to have this, you need to make sure that this, the mandala thing, it's like mandala, it's all about mandala, and it's like, I don't give a fuck, like, mandala, you can call it something else if you want, but basically yeah. As it is right now, and I'm like, oh yeah, shit, like yeah, it's all about the ending, but I'm like, but what about everything else, like is everything, he's like, oh yeah, no, everything else was great. I'm like, okay, well that's a good sign, because we had to have those drafts and step away from it so that we could develop these characters and the story in a cinematic way that is suspenseful and cinematic. So now that we have that stuff, we have to go back and basically bring those elements back in, because now it's like those are like the final puzzle pieces that mm-hmm. that will make it land.
I agree, and we've always had the ending. That's why we didn't give as much attention to it, because it was like, all right, we got the ending, now we got to figure out everything
right.
getting up to it, you know. So that's what we've been doing, like you said, the last couple of drafts, is setting it up well and the pacing and all this other stuff, knowing that we have this big magic trick at the end, but really not paying as much attention to it because we were focusing on so many other things, because we're just like, all right, yeah, it's the ending, it's a badass, it's gonna do its thing, you know, because that's what it was, you know, it's all the elements are there for the ending. So it's funny that we kind of overlooked the biggest part, you know, because we had to go back and do a lot of the grunt work. But yeah, it's good to I'm happy that he's happy with the other parts of it, because that was a worry.
That's what it was all. I mean, like, and it's like we should be really patting ourselves on the back for that, because that was the work. That was the hard part.
Yeah.
That was the hard part that needed to be done.
Yeah. So that's awesome that he liked all the stuff that we just made up, you know, because if I were him, I'd be, well, you took out this from the, like, how many things did we take out from the original? Like 100, you know, from his story. And if I were him, I might've been like, well, where'd that go? But I appreciate that he's kind of like,
yeah. Yeah, it was just like all of his other notes besides that, like there was actually like one, or let me pull it up real quick. There were one or two notes that he had that I was like, yeah, okay, that makes a lot of sense, like logistically.
Yeah, of course.
You know, let's see here. Okay, the first one, 500 people. I'm assuming he's talking about the Matrix Rock Club.
Oh yeah.
So, I mean,
maybe, I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, I could see it still be, maybe what it would, like, what the way I've seen it was that, like, for the Fabric's final show, they were playing in a very intimate venue, which is why you have this huge fucking line outside where, like, the whole intro scene is like mostly everybody is outside. And everyone's like, yeah, I'm just glad to be here. It's like fucking like, yeah, you know, you're not getting in, right? What? You know, like, I still can't stop seeing Adam Driver as that role. Uh-huh. I think that'd be so funny. But you know, like a fat suit on.
Yeah. I just saw, for some reason, I know we had Adam Driver in mind, but when I was like writing descriptions of characters, I was like, Bob's got to be fat. I don't know. I just feel
I agree. He does. So yeah, like, I think that would, that's cool. As long, maybe we just emphasize a little bit more that, like, maybe something Bob says, like, why did you choose such a small venue to play your final show? Maybe it's like, oh, this is the place we played our first show at. And wasn't that like in the fucking draft at some point? I feel like that
probably. So does Uncle Bruce think it should be a bigger place, or
no? He just wrote 500 people. I think that's a creative choice, and I think if we just specify it a little bit more.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so then the next one that he wrote, Lost Phone, but then has it, and that's the one where she's on the roof. Is that no? She's on the roof. She had her phone. Was it?
He's talking about the protest where she lost her phone, and then he found it. Now I think how unlikely that is, right?
No. Well, that's another note that he wrote later on. But there's a first one. I think it's. Can't remember off the top of my head, but I think there was a time before that. Yeah, because Chris finds the phone in the middle of the protest, which is like, yeah, okay, that is kind of a little.
Oh yeah, maybe when she's meeting with Vincelli.
Yes.
I just threw that in there. I wasn't even thinking that she didn't lose her phone, but she wouldn't have had her phone during the show, you know.
Right.
I just threw that in there to give her something to do, and then maybe a little cute little character quirk where she's just like, everyone's got that mental thing. It's like, oh, I have 10 seconds free. Oh, well, let me check my phone real quick, see if anyone, you know, what people tweeted about the show.
Yeah.
And then she doesn't have it. I just was like, I thought, I just picturing her being cute and be like, oh, crap, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that could be a million things. I just wanted to give her something to do while
Yeah. And it's like
that, ideas about that.
That could stay in there, and there could just be a moment where it's just, I think in just terms of like continuity for the story, it's like we saw her with her phone, and the next time we see her, she pulls out her phone, her phone's not there, and then she has it again. It's like, I mean, that's like
and then she does have her phone in the green room with Jeff. You're right.
It's like he has it, she doesn't have it, and then she has it again. It's like she should either just have it the whole time And then like not, you know, maybe when she pulls out her phone, she's like, that could be another moment for her to like check on one of her fucking like campaign things that she's investigating or tweeting or something. Yeah, yeah. You know, yeah. It's like, it's one of those things, like when I like the first three quarters of these notes were things like that, where it's like, oh, okay. That's okay, great. That's a great note. I'm glad that's that, not like,
yeah, well, that makes sense.
Well, like who's this person and why are they doing this? Like, okay. Yeah. So why is Lily frozen in awe upon meeting Chris Becker? I think that just meets, that can be addressed when we, what we should do is we should discuss Chris and really see him as more than just like a vaping fuckboy.
Right. Well, we always talked about that when they met, it was like a planned thing, right? Like
yes.
Chris being right. like a cinematic meeting, you know, he's, mm-hmm. and then I was thinking like just, I guess cosmetically or just for his wardrobe, I only added it in the when we meet him, but like him wearing bright clothes just is like a classic distraction. Like, oh, it's bright, so your eyes are always drawn to him.
Yeah, shiny.
So yeah, so he could always be wearing something that stands out just to kind of keep, you know, Lily's eyes on him, you know, instead of other places. So yeah. But yeah, we've talked about him like being on a set and dancing and his hair.
Yeah. All coordinated. That was back in like the fucking like days where they had like they're holding up like mind control signs and shit, like billboards. So like, yeah, it's like we could still
have frozen in awe might be a little much. I get what he's saying though.
Yeah, like, yeah.
She wouldn't be like, oh, you know, like a cartoon, like oh, like hearts popping out of her eyes.
Right, right. And so also, if we develop his character more as a very believable, trustworthy accomplice, like. The president says, and it's like when she's talking to him at one point and he's like, yeah, like you said, you've got great accomplices. It's like Chris, you know, maybe Jeff and Chris get along. I don't know. Like maybe it's like anything to take away. It's like similar to the vibe where in the version he wrote, where when Barnhart, Vincelli and like two fucking technician doctor guys wearing lab coats show up and they're like, oh, we want you part of, ooh, let's, what's this? Like, it's very suspicious right off the bat. Now it's Matt Damon. Now it's like totally chill. So I feel like we could take it might be wise to take a similar stance with Chris in terms of misdirection, because that, like, when I was up at his house a couple of weeks ago, we were just jamming about Mandala and he was telling me about the laser shows and everything that like when he was writing it and then it like he saw it happen and he's like, holy shit. That was a moment when I, the writer, got fucking terrified at the idea that he was not on her side. Like when the writer gets surprised by the script itself or by the story. So he was very adamant about that being a thing. Yeah. And I, at the time, I'm like, ah, don't worry. We got something cool for you. Wait till you see what we do to Chris. And like, yeah, it's going to be fucking great. Yeah. Which is a cool scene. It's just, you know.
No, I get it. Totally. From his perspective. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was kind of a huge, huge, huge thing in his version of, and in the original version of Mandala, is that he was the last hope, or she was the last hope.
Yeah,
and then so we're waiting to be like, oh, are they gonna do it? Is it gonna be okay? And then it's like, no, he's not even going because he's not even because he lied to her, and she's fucked.
He lied.
Yeah, but I like that. Maybe even so, maybe him and Jeff, like, they could start off, you know, because Jeff has feelings for Lily, obviously. So any new dude, you know, he's never like always. He's protective of her and also just inherently has a little crush. So he's suspect of new pretty guys, you know, dancy boy. Like, so he's immediately suspect, but maybe there can be a moment in there where Jeff, like, they have like a, oh, like, you're a good dude, you know.
Yeah, like, they have like a bonding moment. Similar, it could be like one of those, boom, boom moments where like Jeff is investigating, he's suspicious, and then like Dr. Teen's showing him the fucking TPS reports of the show, and he looks around. Jeff's like, oh, you know what? It just looks like upward mobility to me, and like there could be another scene around there too where it's like he meets Chris, you know, has like a fucking sit down with Chris. And right. Chris is, and it's like, oh, okay. Chris is actually a pretty cool dude. I mean, it's Kit Harington. Like, how could he not? It's like, once you get to know him and like, it's like, oh man, it's like, he's a fucking lovable guy. And that'll be a big fucking plot twist. It's like Jon Snow is a fucking villain the whole time. Fuck.
Right. Yeah. Agreed. That's just another tool of deception we can use. I like that. And we never really went in depth in development for Chris at all. So yeah, he's just kind of there at this point. He's like the last one left. We've talked about everybody.
Yeah, true.
We really haven't talked about Chris except that he used to be a chick and now he's a dude.
Yeah. Sex change operation. And so did Lilith.
The best sex change too. You can't even tell.
Something they have in common. Wow. No wonder we get along so well. You really fuck like a woman. I used to be. yeah so that's I think that, and then like really like I really like the idea still for one production is going on working with the actress who plays Lily and getting her into the mode of what she's going through with this. I like the idea of like having her, is that the town?
Yes.
Yeah, nice. I like the idea of like just telling her only, like, there's a part of you that knows you're the target, but you don't want to admit it. Mm-hmm. But it's not something that is like we, the audience, should ever be suspect to.
Right.
It's like, because that whole thing, it's like the 1-2 punch kill mode is when she's on stage thinking everything's fine and she looks over and sees fucking Chris is standing there with like, and Uncle Bruce suggested, like if it was on a phone, like on her phone or whatever, and like he was supposed to bring that phone to the president, and then like she looks over and sees Chris actually hand the phone to Barnhart or something.
Okay, yeah.
And then Barnhart and she's in mid performance and realizes, oh fuck, oh no. President doesn't know. Oh no, president's still gonna get killed. And then that moment she thinks, oh no, the president's still gonna get killed. And she's looking, maybe she's like trying to look for the president and the president's there and she's like, but she's in fucking mid like Black Swan being like fucking like,
yeah. Well, and the lights too, she wouldn't be able to see like how the lights are on her so intensely. She wouldn't be able to, like, she saw him in the beginning, but there's no way in the middle of the she's gonna be able to turn around and just spot him.
Right. And so like, and just, I love that. It's like this, the final scene of Black Swan is so resonant of this too, because the final performance, she dies and it's this whole like death rebirth thing. But like, I just imagine, it's like, imagine her being like, not only, I never told you about this, but I love the fucking part you wrote in there about like in earlier on in the script when like Lily is downstairs, like in the fucking thing, and she like comes up and does a fucking backflip and like flips out on, that shit's awesome. Like, I'm like, yeah, that's like some superhero Lilith shit. I like that.
Yeah. Like, why the fuck not, man? She's the greatest performer alive that some people are saying.
Yeah.
Let's see it.
So it's like, she's on stage, she thinks everything's fine, she's doing the performance, but she still does that Richie Havens freedom thing. And then that, to me, still meets the whole concept of what her need is to be free and to just, in spite of all the fucking stress and everything, is to just fucking be herself, just to be herself. And that's like, that's her fuck you to Barnhart, even though it's like, you know, she's even though everything's still like, she thinks everything's fine. She foiled the plot, but still she does that fucking act of rebellion. And then, so she does that. And then at some point or another, she looks over and sees fucking Chris and he's got a fucking scary look on his face, like a completely different look, hands the phone to Barnhart. Barnhart just smiles. And then she thinks to herself, oh fuck, the president didn't get the notice. Oh my God, it's still happening. But, you know, she's being flipped around and danced and got wires and shit all over, so she can't do anything about it. But then there's the fucking mandala that appears. The laser mandala with the hologram dragon mandala shit. That, and then she turns around and sees that. And that is when she realizes that, oh, fuck, this is the mind control experiment. Oh, fuck, it's me. Boom, dead.
Yeah, that makes more sense. So did he say anything about the scene where we kill Chris now? Should that even be there, or should it just be should it be more like Barnhart's like, hey, have a good show, blah blah blah, or
So we talked about that.
Okay.
I asked him, like, I told him about Mike's note, and I mentioned the fifth element and how, like, some movies the protagonist and the antagonist don't ever meet, and that's like an interesting concept. I was just wondering, like, after all these notes, and I like, yes, we're going to change these things, but like, given those changes, do you still think it's a good scene to have, like, where Barnhart and Lily have this thing? Because we never really hear Barnhart's perspective. And like I was telling him, like, you and I think that it would be cool to have this fucking like moment between the protagonist and the antagonist. And he said, yeah. But what we discussed was in that scene where, okay, so now Chris doesn't die. Not there.
So would he take the phone and then leave from that place still instead of getting killed there? And then he'd go off and save the president from there. And then a minute later then we see Barnhart.
Yeah. Maybe it's like, it's still a similar thing where like they both, Chris and Lily both hear the recording at the same time. And they're both like, oh fuck, like this is really happening. And it could not just be like a, you know, Chris will be in on it the whole time. Mm-hmm. He's her handler.
Right.
He would be. And then also it's like, he's like, all right, I'll get, it's like, you got to get to, it's like, we need to get to this president. It's like, and he's like, he's going to be here tonight. It's like, oh, here. Oh, he's going to be here. Take the, whatever, take this, get it to the president. It's like, and like, I just imagine on his way out the door, Barnhart and Vincelli come in and they like basically like brush by each other, or Chris gets away. Like Chris like sees them and like Barnhart's there. And every time Barnhart shows up, that ominous tone fucking plays. Like Barnhart door opens up, Barnhart's there and Chris is there, like, oh fuck. And like, he's like, oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. I'll get out of here. And like Lily. So he gets out of there and Lily in her mind thinks, we got him. We got this motherfucker. Mm-hmm. And so what Uncle Bruce was suggesting, and what I like, is instead of Barnhart being like maniacal and fucking straight up like revealing, you know, like, you motherfucker, you bitch, you fuck you, you know, like instead of doing that, he could be like really nice and be like, hey, Lilith, nice to finally meet you. Like, you know, they've been in the room together before, but never formally met. I think the only other time they were together was in the hospital, right?
Yeah.
So like they never spoke.
In the lake too, or in the ocean.
Yeah. Right. That's yeah. So like, and that's cool. I still like that. But like, this is the first time that they actually speak. So Barnhart could come in with a big old smile on his face and be like, "Hi," and it's like Vincelli be like, let me introduce you to James Barnhart, CEO of the V5 Corporation. And Lily is like, you know, trying to keep her, you know, poker face on, be like, oh,
yeah, right.
James Barnhart. Wow. It's like, what an honor to meet you. And he'd be like, oh, wow. It's like, what a great honor to meet you, Lilith. And just love your performance and love everything you're doing. And he could be, what did I write down here? I took down notes here. What I wrote was Barnhart doing bullshit. Lily thinks she knows, and no full or partial disclosure. So basically, it's one of those scenes where like we, the audience, think, you know, we know what both these guys are doing. We think we know We know that Lily knows, that he knows, and we think that Barnhart doesn't know what she knows. And Barnhart's just being like, oh yeah, it's so great you're here. And like, oh, blah, blah, blah. It's gonna be a great show. And the president's gonna be here. And she thinks, you know, like the, you know, she thinks he's going to assassinate the president, basically. So she's like, yeah, the president's going to be here. Yeah. And yeah, he's a really great guy. And it's like, I don't really agree with the president and all that stuff. You know, he steps on our corporate tax laws and shit like that or whatever. You know, just saying some fucking CEO bullshit, which right. Like Lily will just be like, you know, with a smile, like kind of like a smile on her face being like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Just like yesing him, being like, oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's gonna be great, Barnhart. Yeah. Fuck you. Chris is on his way right now.
Yeah.
President's gonna know. You're fucked. You're never gonna get away with this. Like, but they don't actually say any of that. But it's right, all like in the exchange where like the audience is looking at Lily being like, yeah, Lily's got this under control. And Barnhart, I mean, it's like they don't realize, no, Barnhart's got this under control.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. Yeah, that all makes a lot of sense. And then she could be less of a mess, you know, like going on.
Yeah. Stage. Yeah. She could be maybe less of a, yeah, definitely less of a mess. I like the idea, though, that ever since she had that bender, she's on antidepressants and Vincelli's like, I have to insist. It's like, so she's got a different demeanor about it.
Yeah.
When she's not on stage. When she's not on stage, when she goes on stage, it's like, you can't tell. You can't tell that anything's going on. But like she's definitely exhausted as fuck. And also, but also like, I think, you know, the whole political, like leaning more into the political thriller aspect of it too. Let me see like where I wrote notes here. So the hypnosis, political thriller, presence, the target, really content. And I asked Uncle Bruce, like, minus those things that we're going to change, all the stuff with the president, up until that point, was it believable that like, was it part of the perception that the president was the target? And he's like, yeah, absolutely. So okay. if we add more scenes, I think if we add just more scenes with Chris and Lily, mm-hmm. and like really strengthening his role as an accomplice, and also like not just an accomplice like as a friend like Jeff, but also somebody who's like on her side, like feels the same way she does about activism.
Okay, yeah.
You know, to the point where like, you know, maybe the president likes him. You know, like the president really approves of their relationship or something.
Okay.
So that like it's plausible that like it's not like just some, you know, like here, take this to the president, like, oh yeah, sure, I met him that one time, like he might remember me, like he should definitely remember who he fucking is. Mm-hmm. So it's very plausible that like a scene where like, you know, it could even be like we see Chris like run past Barnhart and like running around corridors and just like really total misdirection. Mm-hmm. Like heading up to where the president's booth is, and it's like there's like the maybe he comes face to face with like the Secret Service guy standing at the bottom of the stairwell up to the where the rafter is, where he's the box where he's at. Like we see Chris get all the way up until that point,
and then we don't see him again.
And then we don't see him again until he's on the side of the stage. And then he's got the phone and he just looks at Lilith and just goes like, "Here," just giving her a fucking mad evil eye and just being like, here, and Barnhart's just like
yeah, then he says with his eyes, with that look, then he Barnhart says all the things that he says in the trailer now.
Yeah,
but just look by looking at her like, oh, you thought, but no.
Yeah, nope.
we've already gotten away with it, and turns out it's you and not him. Haha.
Yeah. Yeah. And that another thing too that he mentioned was the lines at the end, like remain calm, everything's under control, when Barnhart's voice says that. He says that in the Pentagon scene. But like if we add more, like add another scene and also other things leading up to this idea about like if we have like a thing about hypnosis, describe like the concept of hypnosis, and then we describe something about like this, I don't know how it'll go in there, if it's part Dr. Teen or fucking Dr. Frazier, like maybe one of those characters can be involved in like the expositionalizing this information about the mandala being a symbol, like a hypnosis event. Like we're going to hypnotize the fucking masses. Mm-hmm. So that like when that fucking dragon mandala appears at the end and she realizes, oh fuck, this is it. And then she's like, oh shit, it's me. And boom, she dies. And then when the voice comes out, remain calm, everything's under control, we in the audience need to be very clear that those are the command words. That's the proverbial snap of the fingers in the hypnosis experiment. So that when the fucking crowd silences, it lands more solidly. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, these are all very doable.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. Like, I mean, there's just some like just character development for Chris, a couple of things here and there with like the mandala mind control shit. And that's basically it, dude. Like,
I'm thinking maybe like Dr. Freezer could have a little thing in there about the hypnotism, because if they're focused on dancing and they can, maybe they we can link it up to like dancing and hypnotizing the crowd, or I don't know, just you know, how movement can manipulate you, or you know.
And then also too, I like that a lot. And then also there could be another scene, maybe not with Jeff, maybe with Jeff, maybe not with Jeff, maybe just we see it could, because every time we see like Liquid Crystal behind the scenes, like the roadies, Jeff is usually like through the eyes of Jeff. So maybe it's like that, or maybe not, but there could be a scene where we're just witnessing like the fucking lasers being activated for the first time, like the first time they're using the lasers that end up being used at the very last performance that we don't see ever used like that again. Like, what it reminds me of is in Iron Man, the first one, where Jeff Bridges is the villain, right? And there's that arc reactor thing that's at the bottom, like the floor, ground level of Stark Tower. And we see this thing, and they're like, what is it? And Iron Man, like Robert Downey Jr. is like, oh, this is the technology that I put in my chest here. And it's like, this is a really important technology. And then like later on at the end of the movie, that's the thing that he uses to kill Jeff Bridges at the end.
Okay.
So there could be a similar type of thing where we see or witness like these tech guys like testing out that laser mandala hologram shit in a prototype kind of way, where there could be some information about how, like, and I think Uncle Bruce could be instrumental as well, as or very helpful with the science behind the laser. When he describes the laser shows, like when I was up there with him and he described the laser shows, how people were literally hypnotized by these fucking abstract fractal laser projections on the screen, because the laser was so fucking vivid. They were using lasers that Uncle Bruce said, like, if you were to shine this laser like at my bed over here, it would burn the bed. It was like that. It was a laser meant for fucking scientific research. And they were like, let's use this for a rock show. Like, and it's funny, like Uncle Bruce is like, yeah, we had to bring it back to the laser people to get repaired. And the scientists got furious with Uncle Bruce and Laser Bob, being like, what the fuck are you doing this with? What are you doing with these lasers?
Yeah.
A rock show? This is science. This is science. How dare you use these lasers for that? So like, if there was a scene where we see these fucking advanced laser cannon shits, like projecting a fucking hologram, like a test hologram of some shit, and the effect that would have on just like, imagine like they were like, you're in the dome, like 2 days before the show, and they're setting everything up, and you got the tech guy, you got roadies over here setting shit up, you got scaffolding guys over here, you got set people over there, there's people all over the place doing their shit, upward mobility and whatnot, and then you got the laser crew that just like projects a fucking like laser hologram in the middle of the thing, and it's just like everybody in the fucking dome just like stops and just stops what they're doing, like drops their fucking like lights drop, like shit just drops. People are just like fucking hypnotized by this laser thing, just to see as a foreshadowing of like, when this fucking thing happens, it will hypnotize people.
I like that. Yeah, that's cool. And that could be more of a Dr. Teen thing if we do it like that. Then I think that's straight up his alley.
Oh God,
I like that visual. Yeah, because that really sets up how powerful that will be. And then if we see I like you saying it like Iron Man, and then we don't see it again until the very end, but then when we do see it at the end, we'll know that it's the same thing that they were messing with before, and we saw the effect it had on regular people, let alone people that are now infected with whatever, you know, they got. So
I like that.
Yeah, that'll definitely make it more.
That in conjunction with another scene somewhere along the line describing the concept of hypnosis, you know, That, what if there's a scene like with Lily and Chris?
That's what I was thinking too. Yeah, you
know, like where they like go to a fucking hypnotist or something. Like they've been set. Like there's a like an on like Tom Cruise when Tom Cruise has, or any major actor for that matter, is on set of a movie. They usually have their own like compound offset, like with their own like caterers and all sorts of shit. Like, and Lily's got the Buddhist with the mandala. They're doing the mandala. There could be like an on-set fucking like hypnotist, like, or somebody that's like there as like a life coach kind of a person. Like, what if there was like a scene where like they like, I don't know.
Yeah. Like, okay. Okay. Just as someone to like explain hypnotism, basically.
Yeah, I think so. I think you know, like that seeing that laser shit, and then also having some sort of actual dialogue where someone explains the concept of hypnosis. That like, it's like when you're in a hypnotic state, you're extremely suggestible. You don't control people's minds, but you can put them into a state of consciousness where they're so suggestible that all you have to do is just suggest an idea to them. And then the action of snapping the fingers, how important that is to wake them up. And then the program is activated and they won't be aware that it's activated. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. like some sort of thing like that, where that in conjunction with the laser shit. And then by the end, when the fucking mandala happens, and she, and Lily needs to be aware of all that shit.
Yeah.
She needs to be somehow involved and personally aware of that. And it could be something that maybe only she knows, that she doesn't even think. It's not something that like she finds out while Jeff's still alive or while Matt's around, and they talk about it like, oh yeah, like the fucking mandala, when the mandala happens, that's when shit's gonna go down. Maybe that could work. But then also, it could also be interesting if it's something that only she sees in the midst of everything, where it's like, you know, because I just imagine her being so consumed by the hustle and bustle of liquid crystal all the time. And she's just like, Jeff's coming over with information, Matt's coming over with information, you know, she's dealing with all this crazy shit. It's like there's shit going on all over the place. And it's like, and when you go back and watch the movie again, it's like, yeah, she's like, everything was laid out. If you know what was coming and you go back and watch it again, you'd be like, oh shit, okay, she knew about it right there. But it was all just subliminal, basically subliminal shit as far as she knew. I don't know how. It's like the how. Yeah. I'm not sure the how, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That'll reveal itself. But yeah, I think that all needs to get in there.
Yeah.
And I think that's very doable. And yeah, like you said, maybe with Chris and her, and we can, you know, kill up multiple birds with one stone, you know, by building up Chris and making him more of a three-dimensional guy, also informing us about hypnotism or stuff like that. Yeah, I think that could be very, very doable. Or we could even have the old, I mean, Vincelli was the original manipulator, right? You know, with his hands and doing but maybe we could even have him in there talking to somebody, or Barnhart or something like that, talking about hypnotizing and
And it's like, it'd be good, interesting for Vincelli too, because, you know, he had that whole thing with the, you know, like, however many days sober. And then like, there's that scene with like in the fucking control room with Barnhart where they're both drinking whiskey, and it's like, oh, okay. Fucking clearly he was lying.
Yeah.
But like, there could be another moment like that where, like Vincelli, maybe like, what if Vincelli is like an avid smoker in the beginning of the movie, and then like there's a hypnotist, like a liquid crystal staffed hypnotist who hypnotizes Vincelli, and he stops smoking. It's like, and when I snap my fingers, the program will be active.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's like boom, and then it's like, and then he never smokes the rest of the movie again.
Yeah, because maybe he's just like a chimney. Maybe it's like a real issue for him, and he's tried everything. But, you know, somebody's like, well, have you tried hypnotism? And that's like the last thing. And I like that. Like, because some people, I think.
Maybe Chris brings it up.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, that, I mean, yeah, who knows? Yeah, well, because he vapes. He's like, well, I vape now instead of smoking. So maybe you should try vaping. And he's like, well, fuck vaping, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, all right, well, you know, if you want to stop, there's a, I know a hypnotist. And then I know, and then I, you know, people have like sober coaches. Like I think Mac Miller, who ended up ODing or whatever, the hip hop artist, he was struggling with, I don't know what drugs he was on, but he had like a sober coach that was like with him on tour and stuff like that. So that could be something along those lines where Vincelli is really, really trying to quit smoking. And where, so he, so much so that he needs somebody with them, you know, all the time, or at least frequently. It's like, oh, the hypnotist is around again because Vincelli's like having a cigarette relapse or some shit like that.
Yeah, it could be something very, very, just very personal with the characters that we already have that just subtly suggests, plants the seed that how easy it is to reprogram you when you're in a hypnotic state. Mm-hmm. And then at the end of the fucking movie, people are put into a fucking hypnotic state and then traumatized, and then everyone's going crazy around the world. And then when they fucking do the remain calm, everything's under control. There could be even another mention of the remain, like of that code word, like remain calm, everything being under control, being like maybe not explicitly directly disclosed as the key words, but like strongly implied to the point where the audience can put it together in their minds enough that when they hear remain calm, everything's under control, and everything goes silent, they're like, oh fuck, you know, like it all happened so quick, and they're like, oh shit, yeah, that was the code word, oh shit, everyone's, oh, she's dead, everyone's brainwashed, and we're fucked. Great ending.
Yeah, we're fucked. yeah, that's a lot to work with, but yeah, like I said, all doable. I know another note of Uncle Bruce's was her getting shot in the leg.
Oh, yeah.
Rubber bullet, and then Dan saying, like, she doesn't have to get shot. I just threw that in there to, like, give her an excuse to lose her phone. Do we think it is ridiculous for her to lose her phone and then Chris to find it? I mean, it is kind of, you know, fortunate.
I mean, does she – is there anything on
her? Not far away. Like, that could be when they get separated, you know? Like, they're really close. He's trying to hold her hand, and then they lose hands. Maybe in that, she could drop her phone in that chaos, so it kind of dropped.
Yeah, because I still like that part. I like, you know, where she loses the phone, and then there's that part where – who was it that – was it Vincelli was trying to call her? And then it cuts to, like, the phone on the ground, and, like, everyone's running around.
I think the president.
The president.
Right. Call her because he sees what's happening. She told him that she was going to be at those protests. And then maybe he sees that it's happening. So he's calling her because he's worried about her.
Maybe instead of just like retrieving her phone, Vincelli just gives her a new phone.
But the whole thing was is that she had the audio.
The audio was already on there at that point?
Wait, was it?
I don't think it was.
Yeah, it was. Because that Chris or Matt calls her. Matt also calls her and leaves her a message when she's at the protest. So I think, so that's – we see that she has a missed call from the president while Matt is calling her. So Matt calls her after he – because he's figuring out the thing at Stanford while she's at the protest, and then stuff starts going crazy, so he tries to send her the file. She doesn't pick up the phone, so he just like messages it to her. And so I suppose he could just send it to her email, and then she could use her new phone to look into her email.
Yeah. I'm glad that these are the issues that we're dealing with.
Agreed.
Not like the first fucking time that
right, like,
oh god, yeah. No. but he's like, I guarantee, when we make these changes, I think he'll be very happy with it. And it's, I was like, when I was texting you the other night, man, it's so trippy because like this guy, producer I used to work with, Chris Decker, from Australia, who is the producer of like a lot of, he produced like big music festivals at like Burning Man and all sorts of festivals around the world. And also made this space, this art space called One Dome. But, right. And it was inside, it was in San Francisco, and I went there on like one of their closing weekends because it was not in a great location. There wasn't a lot of street traffic, like people walking around. So that, like they ended up not, it didn't work out that well. But the whole intention of this place was to, as a proof of concept, so that like if it works, they wanted to make it a dome. It was literally a fucking geometric dome that they would take around the country, around the world, and have this interactive art experience with, like, when I went there, it's all fucking Instagram friendly. They encourage people to go and take pictures. There's all this cool artwork, interactive shit. But then there's this whole area where you put on these augmented reality glasses, like the Microsoft HoloLens, which honestly suck. Like, they're not, the technology is not there yet. You put these big cumbersome glasses on, and then when you're looking through the glasses, you have this like little field of view, like this big, you're looking through, and when you look through that, everything is, there's all sorts of holograms and fucking virtual shit that you can interact with your hands and touch things. And it's like, ideally you'd want to be able to look through these glasses and see everything. But the idea was, is that when you go inside this dome, everyone would be wearing these HoloLenses things, and you'd be able to fucking interact with all this crazy artwork and shit all over the place. I saw it was like a really strange coincidence that we've got Chris Decker and we've got Chris Becker, and we've got, he's the producer of the show, a traveling fucking mandala dome show. Like, I was just like, what the fuck? I'm like, that's
weird. Yeah, That really confused me. I think I maybe had some drinks too, and I was like, "Wait, what is this? Just like an Alex Lipton thing, where you're just like saying shit that is like, whoa!" Or you're like, no, this is real. I was like, "Oh shit!" My mind was just like, "Wait, what?"
Yeah, no. It's too on the nose. Like every little thing about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then like while I was watching The Martian last night, fucking, you got Matt Damon, you got Danny, it's Donald Glover, right?
I always remember it because he was on a talk show and he talked about when he was younger and he realized that his name was Dong Lover, like Don Glover, but Dong Lover. That's if you, it was one word, you know. Dong. But yeah, him and then the other guy who was
Benedict Wong,
who's in
Doctor Strange.
Doctor Strange, yeah, he's number two, right?
Yeah, and he played a character named Wong, and his last name really is Wong. But it's funny, in The Martian, his name is Bruce.
Oh, right, yeah.
Watching this, I'm like, what the fuck?
Thor, come on, come here. Thor, come here.
Any other bigger notes from...
Those were it. Those were the gist of everything. It was like, I wrote optogenetics, hypnosis mandala, political thriller, the president's the target, build up Chris Moore.
Thor, stop.
Hold on one
second. Thor! 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 Poopy!
Come here, Poopy. Get in.
Tuck him in. There's been a couple of times I've been looking at, like, places, and a couple of times I've been looking at places in LA, like, you know, for us, and then I, like, forget to check the, I'm like, oh, this place is really cool, and I'm like, it's like, no dogs. I'm like, oh yeah, fuck, we're going to have four dogs. So then I like go back. It's happened to me a couple of times where I'm like, all right, cool, super cool place. And I was like, oh yeah, we're going to have four dogs.
Yeah. Yeah. There's some cool areas. I haven't looked at in a while, but Highland Park, Eagle Rock, which is sort of like northeast of Echo Park, south of Pasadena. Mm-hmm. It's like near Dodger Stadium around that area.
After putting in the dog filter, there's still plenty, like, there's obviously way less than people who don't accept dogs, but like there's still plenty of places out there, and they're definitely like not just centered in one area of Los Angeles. They're all around town. Tried looking one of the first places, because I was just like, oh fuck it, we'll see if there's anything in Granada Hills. And then I clicked on one of them around there. What was it? Meridian Point, aka NCR. Oh, and I was like, oh my God. They redid all the inside of those. They look like, you know, IKEA came in and put in new cabinets. And, you know. But I was just like, that is trippy. The first one I clicked on was Meridian Point. It shows a picture of the front of the building. I was like, oh my God, that is
Meridian Point.
What was the name of the woman who like worked for Columbia, who worked at that place though? She's like shady, wasn't he? Didn't she like get caught like taking money or something like that? Like,
yeah.
Or was that part of our conspiracy theory about them just like?
No, I think there really was something going on with that. With like Richard Crowe.
Richard Crowe, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, there was some shady shit going on there. What the fuck was going on? Did you ever see the movie Bad Education that came out recently? The new Hugh Jackman movie on HBO?
No.
Based on a true story about this superintendent from Long Island who was involved in this like big money laundering operation, and like they stole all this money from people. And
my sister might have told me about that, but it was a true story.
Yeah, true story. It takes place like when you watch this movie, this is the vibe of the like where I grew up, the New York like public school districts and all that shit. We'll definitely find a place. There's gonna be a place. No doubt about it in my mind.
It's out there. Cool. So I'm not gonna do anything. I'm still like in break mode.
Yeah.
Good. And then also I want to wait until we get the notes back from the screenplay contest, because I don't want to like start doing stuff and then have these notes that are almost, some of them are obsolete, or they'd be really, really hard to work in because we've already taken steps.
Yeah.
I'm sure they'll line up. You know, it wouldn't surprise me at all if they mention Chris and be like, all right. Because the glaring issues are what they addressed before. You know, like they didn't give us a 100-page breakdown. They gave us a 10-page breakdown. So, you know, they had to omit some things that were issues. I'm sure they couldn't have brought up everything. So it would not surprise me if they brought up Chris this time. But so I don't know. I think we'll get that before the results, which is July 30th.
Mm-hmm.
But I think until we get those back, I'm going to still kind of soak it all up and take a mental break. But good. And then we could keep thinking about it. If we come up with clever ways to kind of put in there that we need. But those are great. Those are great notes. And they make a lot of sense. And they make it a little bit more simple because we had to like, we justified her kind of being conscious that she's going to die, but being okay with that. You know, that's kind of, I think we almost or did accomplish it, but it's really more complicated and intense.
Yeah.
She's walking out there to get shot to death and caring about it, really. Whereas now, or what we will implement, which is what it was originally, is that up until the last moment, she thinks it's the president.
And she thinks it's everything's fine.
She thinks it'll most likely be okay. It'll probably, like, we got it. We're on the case.
Yeah. Chris is on it. Chris, we could trust Chris.
Right.
No, we can't.
Yeah. No, we can't.
Yeah, like the last thing we see, it's like we look over and we just see fucking like a vape cloud. Like,
it's him and Vincelli are both vaping together.
Just like, what the fuck?
They're both on either side of Barnhart. Barnhart's smoking a cigar, and then Vincelli and Chris are both just vaping their
vape. Vincelli's just got like a bottle of Jack Daniels and a vape. Like,
it's like all the props to show that they were all lying about everything. Yeah.
Season, the monkey season's there.
Yeah. It's not, it takes off its hat. It's not even a real monkey. It's like a
robot. It's like a robot. Fuck, what the fuck? Yeah, they're all robots.
Like Evil Bill and Ted.
Evil Bill and Ted. Oh my God. I think that this is great. Like the fact that those were the notes.
Yeah.
And like, such a relief.
I was nervous.
I was nervous too, man. Like, especially when I sent it to him and he got back to me so quickly. I'm like, oh shit.
So page one. Oh no.
I'm like, oh no, no. But no, it's like literally all of those notes, except for those final ones that we just like hashed out here, were things that like when I talked to him, like, what was it like? Oh yeah, like little things like cigar between devious teeth.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, those are like little fucking notes.
I'm leaving Prolly in there too.
Yeah, definitely do not take that out. Uncle Bruce's.
I forget who says it, but now I'm gonna make everyone say it.
Yeah,
Prolly.
It's a hip hop phrase. Black people say it. black person thing. Uncle Bruce. But yeah, like the whole thing. Yeah, the ending is very confusing.
Yeah, I get it.
And then, you know, I'm also really anticipating what kind of changes Uncle Bruce will make in terms of the science. Like, that, I'm excited for that. Because, you know, this is the story that he wrote originally, and he obviously cares about it because his name's going to be on it, so he wants to make sure that it's something that he, that is resonant with what he believes in its original inception. So yeah, like, it's, I'm pretty excited, man. I'm pretty fucking excited. Like, the fact, like, because he was really going on all the time, and I kept being like, but okay, yeah, but I agree with you. And I know John's going to agree too. Like, other than that, everything else, what did you think of everything else? And he's like, oh, everything else was great. He's like, I loved it all the way up until the very end. And I'm like,
awesome.
Okay, great. Perfect.
Yeah, that's great. That's best case scenario as far as I'm concerned. Just hearing from Uncle Bruce.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, when you talk to him again, tell him thanks for reading it and thanks for the thoughts.
I will.
And then obviously we'll send it back to him. If he asks for like a time frame, I'm sure he's not like, I need to get it back ASAP because he's a busy dude. But if he asks for a time frame, just say like in a month, I guess, like beginning of August.
Yeah, we'll do. Yeah. Yes, that's really good, man. And it's fucking crazy, dude. Like, just how relevant this story is right now.
and then you sent me that possible
swine flu too. Coming back, swine flu part two. Like, Dr. Fauci's like, guess what? Swine flu's coming back. It's worse than ever. Fuck. Like, of course it is.
So should we like change it back to swine flu then? Like what it was originally instead of this Atlas flu? I mean, I don't really remember the motivation for doing that in the first place.
Yeah.
Well, you run that by Uncle Bruce at some point.
I will.
Because that was originally what he had in there because of that.
Might not be a bad idea. Actually, you know, I think we should. I think we should switch it back to swine flu, but like a mutated version of the swine flu.
Yeah.
The new swine flu. Because, and also that could be an opportunity to further lean into the political thriller aspect of it, where if there's a scene or if we see something in passing on the TV or something about the swine flu. Like, there were those commercials, like the swine flu commercials, like
right.
The pharmaceutical. Isabel. The swine flu, they were like, I got the swine flu vaccine and I feel great. And like, get the swine flu vaccine. Get the swine flu vaccine here today. Dude, I love this thing. Yeah,
that makes more sense. And then obviously it's founded in reality. So if it's like Atlas flu, it's like, well, what the fuck is that? And nobody has really any connection to that. It's like, oh, flu, I get that. But it's like, what the fuck is Atlas? But right. Then if you have swine flu, everyone in the audience will probably have heard of it. You know, oh, swine flu. Yeah, I know that. Like, even if they don't know.
Yeah, people will probably have already gotten a fucking swine flu vaccine before they went and saw the movie. And they'll be like, oh, fuck. Is this part of it? Is this movie run at fucking Illuminati? I heard Bruce Lipton's with the Illuminati. Oh, no.
Yeah, man, that's what we want them. We want to keep them guessing. Is this real?
Yeah.
We want them to be thinking that because it is real.
It is real.
As real as Israel.
Yeah, so having more Chris development in there, I think, you know, and just like in those little moments with the hypnotism and the lasers and just kind of really there, I feel like there could be little moments here and there, especially with Chris and Lily in terms of like being activist partners. Like they're like fucking all-star activists, basically.
Right. There's definitely opportunities already in there right now where like, I don't even have to conjure up a new scenario for them. I feel like there's already two or three or four opportunities for them just to have a different conversation or more of a conversation.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Which is great. Don't have to, it's not a major fucking overhaul or anything like that, which is fucking great. And I honestly did not expect it to be because I've really fucking loved it. Like I really love the script as it is right now. And those notes really are going to make it even better. Bring it, really tie it up at the end.
Agreed. Yeah. And then, this more whatever Uncle Bruce comes up with as far as the scientific lingo, if it actually changes anything, or if he's just being going to clarify everything so it's scientifically accurate. Because so a lot of the stuff in there is still his original wording, but then there's some stuff in there that I just like looked up online, I think.
And yeah.
I might have like gotten the wrong very easily.
And then he was saying too, there's like other stuff, new developments that have happened over the last however 20, 30 years that, like, because I think that's the actual term. It's optogenetics.
Okay.
It's a real field of science that I don't think existed technically back when he wrote it.
39 years ago. It'll be 40 years next year, man.
Dude, talk about, like, we always talked about the mass, like, to become a master of something, you have to spend however many thousands of hours or whatever on a fucking project. How many years this thing has been building and cooking and fucking changing and morphing and changing sexes and fucking vaping and smoking and all this shit.
and then Lily Collins,
dude. Lily Collins.
We didn't make that revelation 5 years ago, that literally just happened a month ago, so it was perfect
timing. And I told you how he was like, when I told him about that, right?
He said it just made a lot of sense.
He not only said it made a lot of sense, but he said like, oh, like he's like, let me see a picture of her. And I pulled up one of the pictures. She's like, oh, all right. What you got to do? You got to make a nice pitch specifically for her and be like, this came from your father. It's like, he was immediately like, yes.
We do still have to come up with the pitch.
We do.
But I like it specifically for her. And then we also have to come up with, what are you playing right now? What a jam.
Her last video got flagged because we had music playing in the background.
Oh, yeah.
Like, this video is blocked in New Zealand. Like, oh.
Oh.
Because
I told you, I really think there is a possibility of making contact with her through Instagram. So
yeah,
if you come up with like, I don't want to send her, a message that's like 40 lines long, I want to send her something kind of concise. So just keep that in mind for, or text me at some point if you're thinking like, oh, this would be a good way to word it. Just something real to the point that kind of shows how cool it is that we went through this whole evolution.
Yeah.
Starting with her dad, ending up on her and blah, blah,
I think,
blah.
I think what would be cool is to make, I told you before, I want to make a synchrocosm video, like a synchrocosm mandala.
Yeah, as part of the pitch.
As part of the pitch, and also have a little, maybe even, have a little thing written, but maybe in the very beginning of the video specifically to send to her, have a little thing where we could even, it could be a visual, like the two of us like doing one of these, like a Zoom call where we just basically introduce ourselves. This is what we're doing. We just really wanted to see this here. Take a look. It's pretty much self-explanatory as it is.
That's probably a more effective way of doing it than sending a
letter.
Yeah.
We could do it all. We could do all.
Yeah, do both. And then, but the letter could be a lot simpler than if we have the synchrocosm video.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get on that, dude.
Yeah, I am. The next, the two synchrocosm videos I'm planning on working on next. There's that one, mandala one first. And then there's one I'm going to work on with Mike, which is going to be the Robin Williams synchrocosm video. I just watched Good Will Hunting this morning.
Mm-hmm.
And, fucking, you could cut every single one of Robin Williams movies together and tell the same story. Like, there's a fucking through line story. Like, he's a teacher, brilliant teacher whose wife died. How many other times has he been a fucking teacher teaching people, like Dead Poet Society? How many other movies did his wife fucking die? Fisher King, What Dreams May Come.
Yeah,
all these things, that's gonna be a real difficult one to do, but the first one I want to work on is the Liquid Crystal mandala, Josie and the Pussycats, fucking Kingsman, all that shit. I'm just gonna put them all in there. Tron Legacy, fucking like the Olympics, 2012 Olympics video. Like, it'll be the ultimate mandala thing, and then put in like clips of like As Tall as Lions and all the put all the really. It's gonna be cool. I'm mentally preparing for that as we speak. Yeah,
I'm excited to see that one myself.
Yeah.
Gus Van Sant. I'm sure you looked it up.
Yes, that's. I saw. I was gonna text you this morning because I didn't look it up, and I was watching.
Oh, you? I did look.
You did? Yeah.
I did look it up. Yeah.
I saw it. I was like, oh, fuck us. Yeah, of course. Like after like however many days of not knowing.
Yeah, I gave up one night and I just looked it up, and as soon as I saw it, I was like, oh yeah, Gus Van Sant. Like I could see it in my head, Gus Van Sant, like a very.
Yeah. Yeah. so good. Sweet.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's like the. I mean, other than.
And then he said something about the vaccines. They don't work instantly.
That's the other thing. Like when he was saying that he's gonna do more.
That's for the science pass.
Science pass of it. Yeah. So.
Cause I didn't fucking know. It was just assumed. Oh, you got it. That's right now.
I told him. I'm like, Uncle Bruce, we're not fucking scientists. Like, you know? Like he's like, it's okay. It's okay. It's like,
well, he'll get credit as creator, producer, and like scientific liaison or whatever. And what are they?
Advisor.
Science advisor. Yeah, yeah.
He's like the Arthur C. Clarke of Mandala.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's exactly what he is.
Yeah.
And dude, you and I are like Stanley Kubrick's legs.
Yeah.
Somebody else is going to be the torso.
Yeah.
We're his hands.
We're his hands. Yeah, we're his hands.
I don't know who's going to be his brain, though.
Yeah. No, it'll just be his brain.
Okay.
His consciousness will holographically, like with lasers, will laser graphically appear inside of whoever the head is. Yeah, fucking. I can see too. Like, you know, it's interesting because last time I saw Chris Decker at that one dome, he was so bummed out because of the fact that this show was like they put so much money and time and effort and creativity into this one dome art space, and then it got shut down because they couldn't afford the upkeep. It was a fucking beautiful building, and everything. He was just so bummed out that like it's like, oh, we're not gonna be able to do this. It's like, well. Maybe it'll happen again. Maybe like Mandala, the One Dome show, in conjunction with an updated version of the laser show that Uncle Bruce did back in the day, where Mandala comes out, and then we also have a fucking like One Dome traveling dome, like Mandala, like virtual experience. That's like its own thing, but also like, you know, in cahoots with Mandala.
Right. It's like, maybe it's like a marketing thing too.
Yeah.
A traveling marketing thing. A dome comes to your city, doubling as this thing with your buddies thing, and also as an advertisement for Mandala, you know?
Yeah.
And we could even, we've briefed on advertising and marketing in the like years and years ago, but I still think that'll be a huge part of it too. It's just creating, you know, just like I remember talking about just putting buying billboards and just putting circles on them, you know, it's like, cause that's, you know,
yeah. Billboard, like let's say it's a 6 month campaign or a year long campaign where we have these billboards set up in every city. And first the billboard, when it shows up, it's just white, like the White Album, nothing.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And then like a month later or a week later or whatever, however many time, you know, it's like, and then there's a circle. And then the next time, then there's the circle, and then there's the other shit. And then, like, as we get closer to Mandala, the fucking Mandala is being constructed before their eyes. And then when the trailers come out for Mandala, that's when the title, like, is on the billboards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. It builds mystery and attention. And, it tells a story in itself, you know, like the evolution. People like that. Like, oh, that billboard was different. And then all of a sudden you're like, because a white billboard, you're probably not going to think twice, but then you're like, wait a minute. And then, and then it's like, well, what's going, something's happening here, which is cool. You know,
what are they going to do next? What are they going to do next? And it's literally like a mandala. It is a mandala. You build the mandala over time. And then once it's done, it's dust in the wind. But in that case, it's like you go see the movie and then you're dust in the wind. Dust, wind, dude.
Yeah, perfect.
So pretty cool, man. I'm excited.
Thanks for talking to him about that and relaying
Thank you.
Thinking about it. Yeah, that's great. I was kind of felt like this was going to be like a student teacher conference, and I was gonna be sitting down and I don't know what my teacher was going to say. Like, and I was nervous about if I was going to get in trouble or not, but it's like, oh no, you're not in trouble. You're doing pretty good. You just got a couple of things you need to fix, a couple of big things, but you need to fix them, but everything else is good. It's like, oh yeah. Fuck. All right. Sweet.
Yeah. And that's the greatest part, because like everything else, that was the process that we needed to go through over the last 13 years to like really do those things that were not in the original story, like the believable characters, a flow, a pacing, suspense, all that shit.
All the shit.
Yeah. So.
All right, man.
All right.
Nice. I would too, man. Do you fuck with your pups with it?
I don't know. I mean, I don't have a way of hooking this up to my
speakers.
I have it on my headphones.
Okay.
Which is probably for the best, just for my like, turn this up and be like, all right, everybody, welcome to Hollywood. Yeah, so pretty cool, man. Looks like Chris is coming back.
Yeah, I'll think about
Lucas and all those guys, and that could be maybe like without even having to like because I agree, taking some time to distance or just a little space from this, especially waiting to get those other notes from the other from the contest. But something maybe we could do at some point is just like we could do a session just on Chris. Like, we can do the whole thing, like what his perceived motivations are. And
yeah, and if he is Kit, is he keeping the accent, and is he from England, is he Welsh? Like, I don't even know. We could come up with that whole backstory there.
That'll be cool. That'll be fun to hash that out. We did with Dr. Teen, and dude, that guy Benedict Wong will be such a great Dr. Teen. Dr. Teen.
I think I'll rewatch The Martian soon. I feel like that. I just need to watch that whole movie in general.
Fucking good movie, man.
Yeah, it is. Awesome.
Really good movie.
Have you read the book? Al is a big advocate of the book.
Oh, no, I didn't. I didn't even realize the book. No,
I
didn't.
I think people love the book.
Yeah. Yeah. Fuck you, Mars. Great, great story.
Yeah, it's funny because when I sent the script to Corey, he was reading it like, he started reading it, I think, the night that I sent it to him, and because he had a little scotch because he was fucking with me. hold on, let me tell you what his email. I was like, "What's your email address?" Because I didn't think I had it, but I did have it, and he sent me one, and I almost sent it to this email address.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. Wait, is Maddie pregnant again, or was she posting?
Yeah, dude, they're having a boy.
Oh shit, that's amazing! I couldn't tell if she was posting older pictures or.
Yep, Corey Jr.
That's awesome. Do you know how far along?
No, I can't remember. They mentioned me. I forgot though, but they're I don't know, pretty. They're along. I think the birthday is somewhere around the same time. I don't know.
Yeah. So I was like, Corey, what's your email? And he sent me boss_hog@diapers.com. Boss and hog. I gave him like the emoji, like the thinking emoji. And then he said, sorry, scotch. And then I literally was like, I almost punched it. And I was like, but I'm gonna feel really stupid if this is not his actual email address.
Yeah.
But for my, it was funny because my last script, the like detective one, I really had Lakeith Stanfield in mind. I think I told you, for the main guy.
Yeah.
Thor, come here. Come here, buddy.
And as soon as Corey started reading Mandala, he was like, oh, for Jeff, you know, he's like, I could totally see Lakeith Stanfield playing the Jeff character. And just reading the first like conspiracy monologue, he's like, I could totally see Lakeith doing that. And I was like, that's really cool because I've been thinking about him for the other thing. And then also him and Donald Glover, like they work, they act together in Atlanta.
Oh, right. Cool.
I just thought that was an interesting coincidence.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I was like deep into researching Lakeith, he apparently didn't know Donald Glover, but he was creating the show Atlanta, because I think he's a creator, and I think he wrote the episodes in the beginning. And Lakeith was just, he's kind of a unique guy. And he said he was just out on the dance floor. He was the only one dancing by himself. Mm-hmm. And Donald Glover, I don't know if he knew who he was, but he went up to him and was like, "Hey, I like your style. I have a perfect character for you that I'm writing in my show." Cause he was just dancing on a dance floor by himself.
Yeah.
So he was like, "This guy's cool and weird. I want him to be in my show." And I think that's how they met.
Huh. Interesting.
But I thought that was cool that Corey thought. But then I was like, "Donald Glover, we actually have in mind for that." He's like, "Oh, that's perfect. Like, he could totally see Donald Glover."
Oh, he said that? Oh, good.
Yeah, yeah. Because cool. I tried to tell everybody who we were kind of thinking of.
Yeah. Give a little, it helps. It helps with the visualization for sure.
Always, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool, man.
Hey. Tight.
Tight.
Tight. That's fantastic.
Yeah, so no rush. But, yeah, I'm definitely down for another talk about Chris in general, and then maybe work on the beginnings of a pitch as well, you know, just to kind of get it down to a science, you know. Yes. It doesn't have to be crazy. It only has to be, how long are pitches?
Enough time that you'd be able to tell somebody in an elevator from the top floor.
Ah, right.
Yeah.
Elevator pitch. I remember them saying.
Yeah. That. Yeah. So cool. Yeah, we could have, you know, that's something also I'd like to do as well. Once we're developing the pitch, I would like to write the, like the cover page for it, which would be like, you know, the summary, the log line, the tagline, plot summary, plot synopsis, story synopsis, all that shit. And I think doing all that also will really help refine like what it is we need to focus on with the pitch. And then like with Lily Collins, especially, that's going to be a very specific pitch. I can see that's going to happen, man.
I agreed. Have you seen the preview for her new movie?
No, I haven't.
I forget. It's Simon Pegg. I think maybe even wrote it, but he's in it. It's kind of like a thriller. And I think she's the lead in it. And the preview looks intense, but it looks good. I forget what it's called, though. I feel like it's maybe a one-word kind of thing.
Movie. Inheritance?
Yes.
Yeah, holy shit.
She inherits, like, her dad dies, and she inherits this thing, and then all of a sudden this wild shit starts happening.
Oh, great.
Yeah, it's worth watching, but it's like she's only getting more and more popular at this point. Mm-hmm. I could really see her kind of being one of the top Hollywood people in the next couple of years, because she's a legit very good actress.
Yeah.
She's not just like a pretty face, like, oh, la-di-da, Jennifer Lawrence, you know, whatever. Jennifer Lawrence is a pretty good actress too, but like, I think she just went on the rise really, really quickly. And same thing with Catwoman, whatever her name is, I always forget.
Halle Berry?
No, newer Catwoman, white Catwoman.
Oh, Anne Hathaway?
Anne Hathaway, yeah.
Yeah.
He's kind of fallen off, but I feel like Lily Collins is definitely like,
yeah. And to pitch this story to her would be the greatest. Mm-hmm. That'd be probably the one of the most unique pitches she'll ever get.
Yeah. Oh,
you know, this story came from your father.
Yeah.
40 years ago.
Yeah. Like what? She's probably born in, I think she's born in 88. So like 6 or 7 years before she was born. I think she's her age.
I think you're right. Let me see.
Maybe 89. But yeah, she's.
Yeah, 89.
89, yeah. Yep. When is it? What?
March 18th.
March 18th, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, when I showed Uncle Bruce the picture, let me see if I can find the picture I showed him.
So that's the one.
Yeah, he was like, yep. You. Oh, he's like, oh, shit. Okay, I'm not finding it right here, but
Uncle Bruce.
Perfect. Pretty great.
Has Aunt Margaret ever gotten into Mandala, or
she's aware of the story? I think she read it at some point. Mm-hmm. Like the one he wrote a long time ago.
Yeah.
I don't think she's read. There have been times like when I'm up there and we'll be talking about Mandala and she kind of like overhears the conversation. We're usually deep into a couple of joints and just like
riffing
about Mandala. And she's like, "Oh, you guys talking about Mandala?" Like, yeah. You know, she'll hear it.
Of course. I'm sure she hears a lot.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, man, yeah, good stuff. Thanks for passing along that wisdom. And yeah, we'll figure out a time to talk, I don't know, next week or whatever.
Yes. And
keep it rolling.
Yes.
I guess, yeah. And then I don't really know my timeline anymore for, like, I'm kind of in limbo about when I'm coming out there still. So I'm going to go camping for a couple days in the next couple of weeks just to kind of clear my head and then hopefully, you know, do some shamanic ritual out in the woods. And
ooh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm having fun with my new toy.
There's an opportunity to be super cliche and like all these, you know, a lot of these new movies the last couple of years, the previews have all been like modernized, really sexy versions of older songs, you know?
Yeah.
Like I feel like there's been a lot of movies, like the trailers have all been like, I feel like there's going to be an opportunity for us to remake like a super cool, sexy electronic out of time remake.
I can see that song being the final song, like it plays during the credits, like after after a fucking, you know, first couple of credits come up and it's still silence.
Yeah.
Because I think that needs to sit with people.
It needs to sit for a minute, but that would be funny though. Like after a minute, it's literally just like, he's just like, what?
What?
How am I supposed to feel right now?
I suppose it's supposed to be good. Like, is that good? I don't feel good.
We could just play the music video because we've talked about that music.
Oh, yeah, that fucking video, dude.
Just play the music video for the credits.
Yes, that'll be it. And then just like Barnhart just like doing his red card scene.
Or we could CGI Barnhart dance into the music video, the original music video. He could be dancing around with the red cards in the music video.
Yeah. Oh, my God, Barnhart.
The technology will be available.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Cool, man.
Thanks. Well, great
stuff. Yeah, I feel good.
I'll upload this one.
Yeah, I'll need to look it over and write some stuff.
For sure. For sure. But yeah, all in all, really good, man. Good omens.
For sure. We're close. We're closer than we've ever been. That's
closer than we've ever been. Closer than we've ever been. Hello? Anybody here? Hello? There's all these other crazy effects, too.
They're, like, built into the soundboard, or what?
Yeah, there's, like, there's effects built into the switcher. Or the,
nice. That's fun. That'd be a lot of fun. Play with that shit all the time.
Flanger. Oh, nope. Flanger, hello? No.
Figure it out, man.
Flanger. Nope.
Maybe you should say a different word.
Different word. Yeah, there's all sorts of effects on here.
That's cool. I look forward to the unnecessary use of those in our podcast in the future.
Oh God, we're going to have so many unnecessary shit, so much unnecessary shit going on. Should call it, Bob and Doug meet Lucas and Lenny. I wouldn't be surprised if they're the next astronauts that go into fucking space. Lucas and Lenny on the next SpaceX travel. Yep. Well, we had to let them go so that they can further their career and purvey their mobility into space.
Doesn't get more upward mobility than outer space.
That's the most upward of mobilities, yeah. Cool, right, brother. Man. Well, great to see you, man. Glad we talked. And send my love to your family.
Right back at you, man. Thank you.
Yeah. And let's connect soon I was trying to register the script on my iPad, but apparently it doesn't work with iPad, so I'm going to do it tonight on my desktop. Okay. But cool. Yeah, no big deal. So I'm putting you as author number one, me as author number two. You'll be the registrant, but then we'll both be on there and everything. So it'll
cool.
And then what we do, we just got to keep an eye on it every 5 years. We just got to renew it.
Perfect. Yeah, I didn't think about that.
I assumed that it was like once it's registered. It's
yeah,
like,
yeah. I did too, but I guess that kind of makes sense. All right, yeah, but thanks for doing that.
Yeah. And the story has changed so much since that time anyway, so.
True.
You need a new serial number.
True that.
All right, brother, man. Well, always great to see you.
You as well. Good chatting. We'll talk to you soon. Have a good rest of your night.
All right, you too, man. Talk to you soon.
Peace.
Remain calm. Under control. Oh, shit. Later, dude.